Rabbi Tendler is the Mora D'Asra of the Community Synagogue of Muncie. He's a Rosh Yeshiva at Reach, Yeshiva Ben Yitzchak Elchanan. He is the Rabbi Isaac and Bella Tendler Professor of Jewish Medical Ethics and Professor of Biology at Yeshiva University. Rabbi Tendler is known as one of the leading experts on medical ethics as it pertains to Jewish law. And it really is a pleasure for us, to have him address us tonight and find the time in his very busy schedule to come here. It's my pleasure to introduce Rabbi Dr. Moshe David Tendler.
Do you want the microphone?
Yeah.
Do you want?
If I could do that, I would
rather. Without, it's a try.
Hold this in my hand better. Is this better? Okay. I'm impressed that there was nothing on television tonight that was worthwhile watching. And I'm honored by the Olim here. And the opportunity, I hope. Let's try this one. We'll try it. And the opportunity to clarify what really has been clear for so many years, and that is the halachic definition of when a person is no longer alive. Make sure that I don't underestimate the significance of what has happened the last few weeks. I want to call your attention to what has been one of the most dramatic Chilul Hashem incidents in American Jewish community. I'll be showing some letters from people on the slides. But the statement that has been now several weeks without being refuted, that according to halacha, as interpreted by some of the rabbonim who, I'm choosing my words, have not the slightest idea of what we're talking about. Not the slightest, as I'll show you. Nevertheless, came to the conclusion that a goy who is brain dead may have his organs removed and given to a Jew, but a Jew cannot have his organs removed because when he's brain dead, he's still alive. That has to be refuted, as the Chilul Hashem endangers us in the eyes of an anti-Semitic world. It's as close to a blood libel as you can come. You can kill a goy to save a Jew. No manoshach. If brain dead is alive, then both are alive. If brain dead is dead, then both are dead. That must be refuted, and I'm embarrassed to say that despite this obvious observation, no one has had the decency to correct that impression from the RCA administration. This is an educational evening. Let me define a term for you. Brainstem death. Neurological death, respiratory death, are all synonyms. Respiratory death is a key is the key final test in determining brainstem death. So brainstem death, you have to understand, is a chumrah above the definition of death, which is the one that the Gemara gives. Kol asher nishmas ruach chayim biapo. Respiratory death is death. But, excuse me for using a more pedagogic approach because the issue is so critical. I'll be showing some of this in slides. But the Gemara that concluded, the Gemara in Yuma Daf Pehe, that concluded that respiratory death is death because of the pasuk Kol asher nishmas ruach chayim biapo. None of the people who wrote about it bothered to take a look in Rashi. My father, Zatzal, I learned with my father, he had some Yiddish expressions from his years in Raden. Men darf zählen Werte in Rashi. You have to count the words in Rashi. You don't zoop to Rashi. And Rashi's comment on that Gemara is, Mi sheshochev kimes, she'ein misnaya nanei heivorim, or similar. He lies motionless. He looks dead. Then, to ascertain, is he dead? Then every Chevra Kadisha leader knew what to do. He pulled out a feather from his pocket and held it to the nose. If he doesn't breathe, he's dead. Brainstem death is not the cause of death. If you determine that he's brainstem dead, it means he had died. When, I don't know. But now he's surely dead. Therefore, it's an indicia of death, that death had occurred. This is the definition of brainstem death, internationally accepted. There's no country that has modified it. The issue is, very simply, that it's the only way we can be sure someone is dead. Because cardiac death is reversible. Brainstem death has never been, not reversed, has never been ameliorated. And this is one of the blatant lies in the RCA issue that they put out, this 110 pages of drivel, in which they said, well, some brainstem people wake up. In the history of medicine, it never happened that someone who was declared brainstem dead on the basis of the protocol which has been approved, and I will show you what the protocol is, has ever shown any improvement, let alone gotten better. That's critical. You have to know and understand that. And why that got into a printed document with the RCA imprimatur on it can only be assumed to have been willful, because there is nothing in literature that would justify it. Back a little bit to understand why we, as a Jewish community, as a Torah community, are involved so heavily in medicine. There are three psukim. The first, we Kadosh Baruch Hu allows you to be a doctor. Berapo yirape mikan shenitna reshus l'rofe l'rapos. Because what kind of a chutzpah do you have? You know he got sick because Kadosh Baruch Hu let him get sick. And you're going to counter Kadosh Baruch Hu's will? So Kadosh Baruch Hu says, mind your own business. You do what you're supposed to do, I do what I would do. If you won't go to a doctor, God will not help. If you go to a doctor and don't ask God to help, God will not help. Without Tehillim, there's no medicine. But without medicine, Tehillim doesn't help either. We are not faith healers. Kadosh Baruch Hu gave a world governed by natural law. and therefore expects us to behave in that way. The second posuk says, but they're very nice, that's not none of my business. So what? People are sick. What am I supposed to do? And Kodesh Baruch Hu says, if you have to return his lost wallet, Vashevosolo, how much more must you return his lost health? Therefore, the Chiv Ashavas Aveda. But a wallet, I know how to return. I look inside, there's an address, a telephone number. I can become the Mitzvah Ashavas Aveda. I'm not a doctor. How can I return someone's lost health? Comes the next pasuk, Lo Samar Adam Re'echa, which is the basis for national health care. Hire a doctor. Pay money. Aguri Ogil. Spend money to get a doctor. That makes it a din d'oraisa. I have to worry about someone else who's sick. That's why we're concerned. How do you make people well? And if I can make people well by doing a transplant of a liver, a heart, a lung, a kidney, it's my responsibility to do so. This is an unbelievable tshuva of my great father-in-law Zatzal. Rav Weiss Zatzal was then Rav in Manchester. I saw up in the year I went there to speak at his graduation. And there was a exchange of letters. This letter I happened to bring personally to him. Exchange of letters between Rav Weiss and my Shver Zatzal. When the Shver had written that there is a mitzvah to donate an organ, referring to a cadaver organ, nothing talking about brainstem death that came in much later. And Rav Weiss answered, very astute comment, the halacha never causes pain. We have no mitzvah that demands that you suffer pain, except for two, Mila and Yom Kippur. And Rav Weiss said, you say we should allow a loved one to be used as a donor. There's so much pain to the family thinking that their loved one is being mutilated. Then shouldn't that be a reason not to demand that organ donation be allowed? And my Shver answered, you don't understand. The mitzvah is not to have pain. The mitzvah of saving a life is a tzivui, don't you have pain? And therefore, it's a mitzvah that has to be performed. That's the last way online. It says, you're saving someone's life. There's no pain. Okay. This is the biology professor business. Okay. What are we talking about? We're talking about that area called the brainstem that governs breathing, among other things. You have to understand that there is the area above, which is the area that controls thinking, emotion, etc., there, which is now under attack because the definition of brainstem death is total cessation of all functions of the brain, including the brainstem. But all functions of the brain, there's a big movement today, say it does make sense. If the cerebrum isn't functioning, even though he's breathing, but he can't feel, can't think, etc., he's lost his humanhood. Why can't he be used as an organ donor? That's part of the problem known as a slippery slope. When you give them a finger, they want the elbow. It's a problem. Problem in public social ethics. In halacha, we make a gzeirah d'rabbanan to prevent that from happening. This is the brainstem death, the definition, directly from the congressional publication. Irreversible cessation of all function of the entire brain, including the brainstem. That's known as now they call it brainstem death, but its better term is neurological death. That's the term that most people prefer to use in the field. The brainstem terminology got into the field. It's hard to do without it. Okay, people can read it nice and clear. Nucleus scanning is the most useful confirmatory test. Explain that to you. Something that those who wrote that 110-page nonsense from the RCA had the slightest idea what that's all about. Let me tell you what the nucleus scan is. It's a way of determining the circulation reach the brain. Now, in that 110-page thing, they have a statement there that it's not possible to visualize the brainstem. And they quote a source. That source is 49 years old. We have no trouble injecting a radioisotope. And I'll show you some pictures. And showing that the radioisotope never reached the base of the brain. It, all over the body, you can pick up the radiation, but not in the skull. Why? When a person is in an automobile crash, they are the best donors. If you wanted to increase donations, the Rabbanim were interested, they would put an iso on wearing a seatbelt. When you hit up against the windshield, the skull stops and the brain keeps on moving and hits up against the skull. When you hit your knee, it swells. You hit the brain swells. Therefore, emergency treatment often is drill a hole in the skull to let the pressure out. But if you don't, and only minutes go by, 20, 30, 40 minutes go by, the pressure in the skull builds up. If it's higher than your blood pressure, no blood reaches the skull. The back pressure is too great. That's why you get brainstem death. The idea of packing the head with ice cubes and so on is an attempt to reduce the swelling so that that doesn't happen. All cases I've been involved in, there are several every year, we always insist on the nucleus scan, and in my Shreel's Tshuva, he mentions that. It's something they don't like to do, and after many years, my father-in-law Zatzal said he doesn't think it's necessary to do the nucleus scan. He felt that the clinical evaluation is more than adequate. As he always would say, he says, what did we do in Luban? In Luban, the fellow looked like he was dead. The Chevah Kadisha fellow took out a feather, and we buried him. That's all. This is important to know. Harrison's principle of internal medicine is the equivalent of Baba Basra. If the boys have no time to do exercise, we assign them Sefta Baba Basra, schlepping that ball around. It's about as much exercise they'll get. In medical school, Harrison does the same thing. Same account. Okay, this is the critical thing. This was never seen by any of the people who wrote the RCA. That includes Rav Schachter, Rav Willig, Rav Bleich. They have the slightest idea what this is all about. This is the protocol. No one deviates from this protocol. Whether it's England, America, Germany, France, this is the protocol. And hidden in the bottom of the protocol is one line. apnea testing is performed if no other evidence of brainstem function has been noted and there is no spontaneous ventilatory movement. English translation, if he doesn't breathe. Before you do this test, you don't check whether he's breathing or not. He's on a machine. Of course he's breathing. What if I stop the machine, but he still breathes? I don't know. I have to try it. I will not try it unless he fails all these tests. And these tests basically are to measure the activity of the cranial nerves coming out of the brain. Once it shows that those nerves are no longer functioning, we must assume the brain isn't functioning either, but we have to check it. And that's the apnea test. That's kol asher nishmas ruach chayim biapo. This is what Rashi meant, im shochiv kemes. How do we shochiv kemes? I go through this protocol. I shine a light in his eyes, the pupils don't respond. I go ahead and I put ice water in his ear, that should cause the ice to move, doesn't respond. I go ahead and I put a stick down his throat, he doesn't gag. Then I go ahead and check by shutting off the machine, the pump of the machine. I leave the oxygen still dribbling into him. There's no danger to his life if he's alive. And you wait to see, does he ever take a single breath? Nowadays, many of our machines have what's called a sigh meter, where it measures if he ever took an independent breath. So we pretty well know, by the time we're doing these tests, we pretty well know whether he can breathe or not. But that the test must be done exactly this way. That's why it never happened that someone did so. The doctor did the test, and his patient got better in any way. Now, there are cases where they bury people and they find out that he wasn't dead. That has nothing to do with the science of the issue. Here's what I meant by the nuclear scan. This is what you see. This is a scan in which the, what they call a hole in head syndrome, in which the radiation couldn't get past this line over here. That shows that no blood has reached the brain. Now, it doesn't take too much seichel to know any organ of the body. Put a rubber band on your finger, leave it there for 30 minutes, you lose your finger. If there's no blood, the organ to be supplied is dead. And this is all, I'm sure the doctors know all this. But these are, it's a rigid protocol that must be followed exactly. Here's the results of an autopsy after a person was brain dead. What did they find? I don't want to have you people trouble sleeping tonight, but they find that pieces of the brain are in the spinal column. The brain is falling apart. Go past that. Now we're coming to an interesting thing. I was in contact with Shlomo Zalman Auerbach Zatzal. And by the way, I should mention, there's one person missing here, he couldn't come, to whom we owe a tremendous debt of gratitude for all the work he's done. One, his own brilliance in as a Talmud Chacham and as a fabulous physician. I'm referring to Dr. Avraham, Rav Avraham Steinberg, there, who has done much of the explanation, much of the careful analysis of the medical facts so that the Rabbonim, who were willing to listen, were able to come to the conclusion that in Eretz Yisrael, neurological death, or brainstem death, is halachically adequate, and therefore we have in Eretz Yisrael transplants of heart, etc., etc. Again, a heart, lung, most likely liver, but heart and lung must be taken only from a brainstem dead patient. It cannot be taken from a patient whose heart has stopped beating. Now here comes an interesting case. The parents of this young lady pleaded with the doctors. She was declared brain dead, and she's in the later months of pregnancy. They pleaded with the doctors to keep her alive, quote, quotation marks, right, until the baby could be delivered. but she was declared brain dead. They did so, if I remember the article, it cost the parents $260,000 to pay for the care that she needed in order for it to happen, and they delivered a live baby. When this came out, I mailed it to Rav Shlomo Zalman, and his response was, well, that proves that brainstem death is not death. Because the Gemara in Erech and Daf Ches, I'll show it, says that when a pregnant woman dies, the baby always dies first, because chayus zutra is hold on life is less than the mother's. And if in this case the baby was born alive, that proves the mother was not dead. That led to a tremendous experiment controlled by Rav Steinberg, in which we got a pregnant sheep and cut off the head. I have a movie of the whole thing, which I show every year in ethics class, and my daughter, Lucy Freed, shows it in the girls' school in so-called Central High School.
Yeah. With Shrita?
Hmm?
With Shrita?
No. It's a dramatic movie. They had to put the knee on the animal to break off the head. And kept the animal on a respirator. And hours later, they called in an obstetrician from Shari Tzedek, and he did a cesarean section, delivered a live lamb. Now here, no one could argue that sheep was dead, because there was no dispute that when someone is decapitated, he's dead. I introduced a term in the medical field, physiological decapitation is the definition of brainstem death. As I said, the blood doesn't reach the brain, so the brain dies. My nafkamina, whether it's still attached to the body or not attached to the body, the brain is dead, hence the individual has been decapitated physiologically. As we see, the refutation of this concept exists in some writings by Rabbi Bleich. I will be showing them in a minute. What did we do here? This experiment proved something. So in that article, those who read the 110-page thing, it says there, this experiment was meaningless. It didn't say anything. The head doesn't work. No experiment says anything. What the experiment said was that a beating heart is not alive. For this sheep was perfectly, the heart, by the way, the blood pressure didn't drop by one unit. When we setting up the experiment, I had called Cornell and asked, who knows what's going to be, give me a little lean. They said, you can't do it. The blood pressure will come plummeting down, and you lose the sheep, it won't work. Not true, worked fine. It means a beating heart, unless you say that sheep is alive. And you can't say it's alive because the head isn't there. Because halacha says, we'll see a Mishnah, I'll give you the halacha soon. The Mishnah says, decapitated is instant death. Metame be'ohel. A coin can't walk in. And here it showed that a beating heart doesn't end, but we knew that before. I could take out a beating heart and put it in a bucket of salt water under my desk and come back in the morning, it'll still be beating. You know, as I remember those terrible days now when I taught every course in biology, there, including the Bio-1A labs, right, where we cut open a live frog and take out the heart and put it in a Syracuse dish with salt water, and the kids would bet whose heart would beat longer. No problem. Hours. This lab was 4 hours. End of the lab, the heart is still beating. The frog is in the wastebasket, but the heart is alive. The heart is an organ, doesn't depend on anything. It has no pacemaker. It does whatever it wants. It even sometimes makes the wrong matrimonial choices. Here's basically Rav Steinberg's summation. Our experiment has proven that a decapitated animal, as an intensive care setup, is capable of maintaining normal circulation, etc. A normal newborn can be delivered. Therefore, the case of that lady, she was dead, but her organs were alive. And here, just quickly, death occurs in three stages. The first is called organismal death, when the organism is no longer functioning. That happens when you take the head off. But the organs are fine. Provide them with fluid and glucose, they'll keep on going. And then comes a time when the organs start failing. But the cells in the organs are doing fine. The organism as a whole, the organization of the organ, but the cells are independent. And then the cells start dying. That's putrefaction. That's when it decays. That's what the case of the brain falling into the spinal column was a case already of cellular death, not only organismal death and organ death. Okay, if people want to read that quickly. Okay. Now a little bit, really, in the audience, we have Rabbi Berman, who's done, Baruch Hashem, yeoman's work in Al Pi Halacha, in making the Jewish community aware of their responsibility of Lo Samo L'Adam Re'echo, that they have to do something to save someone's life if they can. But we find that the Jewish community is not too cooperative. We don't find there are adequate donors from the Jewish community. And in Israel especially, Israel, as you unfortunately know, has one of the highest accident rates. And therefore, they should have the largest number of donors. There's an international donor bank, and Israel have to contribute in order to get organs from the donor bank. But in Israel, as some of you may know, there's a system known as overdraft. That as long as you have checks, you can write checks. But there's money behind it, that's not important. Right? They tried to do that with the organ bank, and they got bumped. An Israeli cannot get an organ in England or France or Germany. America still allows, but on the bottom of the list. And when this information would come out, God forbid, internationally, that we do take organs from Goyim and give it to Jews, no Jew will get an organ anyplace. And I want to repeat again, in all this tumult that's happened all over England, America, Israel, RCA hasn't had the decency to at least retract that one point. And that's a chiv I put on anyone sitting here, and RCA members here, that you must demand. You are endangering my life by not demanding it. Right. So here, these are the reasons that people give why they don't want to be donors. Right? Nivul Hames, desecration of the deceased. There's no Nivul Hames when someone is an organ donor. That's Kovav Hames. Isur Hano Min Hames. You don't want Pikuch Nefesh. All these halachas don't apply. But in the mind of the layman, these are reasons. The last reason is the most common one given. I deal with this on a monthly basis. Well, what's going to be? If I give away my organs, comes Tchias Hamesim, where will I get an organ? I always tell them the same way Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov will get their organs. All we need is one molecule of DNA. It could be in there in the grave. And Kodesh Baruch Hu can build up a whole body from it. And then comes that problem. They have Rabbonim. Abraham, who was a member of the medical staff here, was the first one to attack the tshuva of my father-in-law Zatzal, an absolutely disgraceful statement that Rabbi Feinstein meant after the heart stops, you have to wait for brainstem death. No doctor could possibly make such a statement. But he did and published it. And it took Shari Tzedek, the Asiyah, to call him to task on it. But he never backed off. Left it as a suffix. Did Rabbi Feinstein really mean to accept brainstem death, or was only after cardiac death? Now, which person would call the Rav and ask a Shaila, I have a patient, right? Heart stopped, right? Is he still alive? You tell him, yes, he's still alive. That's it. Two shittes, right? This we can do without. This is something we wrote, I and Fred Rosner, a letter to the editor of JAMA in 1989. Okay, this is, I think, sums it up nicely. Yeah, but not so funny. This term has hurt us greatly. He's dead, but he's on life. That's how doctors talk. Doctors, thank God, they know some medicine. Supposed to speak English also. That means he's on life support system. That's what he's saying. He's dead, but he's on life support system. He's on life support system, he's not dead. But it should be, he's on an organ perfusion system. His organs are being perfused, but he's dead. He's not on life support. Okay, this is important for what comes later. People who work in the Chevra Kadisha know these stories, they're true. And sometimes this is long after the cardiac death, etc. Sometimes in handling the body, it seems the body is moving. We had a case in Muncie where the body stood up, sat up. Caused two heart attacks. Why? Because the spinal cord is still alive. And by twisting the head when handling the body, sent a message down the spinal cord. Those are spinal cord movements. That says these are movements after death. People say, but you see, sometimes I handle the body and the hand seems to jerk. Those are spinal movements. Critical to know. Why? They occur when the head is removed. As we'll see, much studied during the French Revolution, where that whole bunch of people without heads running around, those who made the revolution, right? And those who were executed in the revolution. Now let's go slowly. This is, Baruch Hashem, God was kind to me for the first time in many, many years. We said shiurim in Meseches Nidah. Oh, in Hilchos Nidah we learned, but Meseches Nidah, and I had agreed to do so. We had two wonderful years of studying Meseches Nidah and came up with special things for the lecture tonight. I'm sure that's the only reason we decided to learn Meseches Nidah, right? What does it say? Omar Rab Zeira. I may have it in English too. Yeah. Rab Zeira said, I don't longer answer shailas on need the blood. I don't understand the science of Bavel. How can I ask shailas? Try that in most communities here in Eretz Yisrael, and you'll find out the conclusion has to be they must not pass kashayas. Because they don't understand the minimum that a person needs in order to be able to pass kashayas. Give it back, you take those in Hebrew, it looks even better. Amar Zera, Tivid Abovil Gomali, The advancing science of Bavel caused me to lo chazoi doma. Damina betiva lo yadana bedoma yadana. This now becomes a real problem. This is classified in most circles today of the Torah world as apikursus. The Gaon said, and this is the Gaon, this has a pointer too. This is written by Rabbi Mishklov, the famous Talmud of Vilna Gaon. What did he say?
Whatever you're lacking in secular knowledge, right?
You'll know 100 times less in Torah knowledge. Who would say such a thing nowadays? Break the windows. I mean, but that's the fact. The Torah was given for our society, for our people, for our stage of knowledge, unless the Talmud Chacham is willing to keep up, he will not understand anything about the halacha. My great Shreel Zatzal, the question was posed to him after we gave a conference at Mount Sinai, and they posed the question, what about the Harvard criteria from a Jewish point of view? We'll talk about it in a minute. And I tried to explain to my father-in-law what how our criteria are and what we're trying to do to differentiate between PVS, persistent vegetative state, where a person is in coma and wakes up 20 years later, and someone who is brainstem dead. How do you make the difference? The doctors couldn't explain it. We had doctors coming. Dr. Edelman is here. He was one of the doctors who came in to see my trail. With Dr. Greifer, who was then head of nephrology, right, nephrology at Einstein, there, they came to talk to my father-in-law. I brought in him. I brought in Frank Veith. I brought in Greg Smith, the great transplant surgeon, heart transplant surgeon, etc., so that my shvel could hear it. He's a goyim coming in to explain. My shvel understood English. He was able to respond to them in English. It took him 2 years to make up his mind, because they didn't know what they were talking about. They couldn't make a clear differentiation. And finally, that protocol began to make it clear. Why? To show that the projections of the brain, the cranial nerves, are not functioning. And then to come with that final decision that apnea, what the Torah says, that apnea, absence of ability to breathe, is indeed a sign of death. Well, that just blows it up for you to see it. Now, the Vilna Gaon was one of us, remember? Didn't study in Cincinnati, right? Right. Here's a nice quote from the Hamidogo in the Chumash, on the menorah, the symbol of Am Yisrael, of Eretz Yisrael. Menorah has seven arms. He says, "Hine shishav kani menorah, imanera amsoim, hin sheva chochmos chitzonios hatfelu, ushatora tzricher lahem lisporeit b'chopoti." The six represent all knowledge. And the seventh, the central one, is Torah knowledge. Without the sixth, you cannot understand the seventh. The sixth provides the information that's fit for society. And the seventh, the Torah humanizes it so that it can be used by society. That's the relationship we have. Without knowing this, now who, this is the Nitziv,
right, in Hamidot, saying the same thing the Gaon said only years later. All right, now here comes really a critical one. That's again my debt to yeshivas. Therese is inestimable. Baruch Hashem, having to teach the Masechta each year, you get wonderful things. It's good enough even for a lecture on brainstem death. What does he say? The Gemara there gives. Do we have it there? No. Okay. He says, the Gemara there speaks about how to treat basically migraine headache, I think it must be. It says you cook up this herb and that herb, and you 300 cups of fluid this has to be poured on the head, etc. So comes along Rav Shiloi Gaon in the Sefer Gittin on that daf and says, right, remember, you should know that what? Anan lamei malachut. Rabbanan lav asusi inun. Rabbis are not doctors. Only recently we have a rabbi doctor, right? That when the community got sick, the rabbi got doctors. Right? He says, lav asusi, they're not doctors. But therefore, milin ba'alma chazinim is manehim. They just saw the same thing you saw in their own time. Therefore, you should know, hilkoch, don't you trust them? Don't do anything they tell you. You go to a good doctor, he tells you what to do, that's what you're supposed to do. They know what Aristotle, Galen, Hippocrates taught them. They don't know what Moshe Rabbeinu taught, he didn't teach those things. Therefore, they're talking ex cathedra, they have no special yichus. And therefore, they can change their mind when the doctors tell them what to do the next time. Okay. This is the key Mishnah. A Mishnah Olos, what does it say? Hutzo Roshayim, if the head is chopped off, even though they are still showing motion, Mepachasin, like Tameim, he's an Odom Tomei, it's no different than the tail of a lizard. Zono Shalal Tor. You can grab the tail of a lizard, and the lizard says, you want the tail so badly, you can keep it. And he runs away, and you're left with a tail in your hand that's twiggly, that's twitching. That's not alive. So the man who had his head cut off is not alive. Even though the heart is still beating. When you cut the head off, the heart will keep on beating. Because the heart is not a sign of life. The heart is an autonomous organ, it does what it wants. This is the Gemara, the key Gemara, and I think I have the Rashi blown up. Right. Vinya Piku, Rebbe, etc. of Ashol says, what's the test of life? Kosha Nishra Sul Chai Biapo. I think they have the one. Yeah. Here's the Rashi. Im doma lemes, sheino mezes evolo. He doesn't move. That's the protocol. Right? That's what the protocol is. Exactly what Rashi says. First check. Does there any kind of movement? I put a stick down his throat. He doesn't say anything. Doesn't move. Doesn't gag. Right? Im doma lemes, sheino mezes evolo. Ad hechon hu mfakeh. How much do you have to dig him out if he's buried on the ladas haemes? At chokmo, the main chius, the chokmo, shein motzu ruach vadeimes. Period. That's been the aloche from time immemorial. Okay. Here's a wonderful Gemara. Gemara in Chulin, Eli HaKohen fell off his chair when he heard that they captured the ark, right? And it says he broke his neck and was dead. And the Gemara interprets that instantaneous death, right? Vatishba mafakta vayomosk. Her heart was surely beating. He's dead because the connection between the brain and the body was severed. He was decapitated, even though it didn't see it. You couldn't see it from the outside. But internally, he was decapitated. This is the Gemara I made reference to, that Shlomo Zalman Zatzal questioned brain death, since the mother was able to keep a live baby going. Right? That's the Gemara there. And I have a blue that went up too. Yeah. The Gemara says, right? Davlad zutru teyusa, right? Therefore, the Malach HaMoves kills it first. Shlomo Zalman, when we showed that experiment to him, he said, well, obviously, when it's on a ventilator, the halach is different. That even though the person is dead, the organs still be kept alive. Now, I'll say this, I know it's being recorded. I met Shlomo Zalman many times. He always approved the brainstem death, period. What he did say, though, and Dr. Edelman, excuse me, he said, but only in America, because in Israel, they'll take your heart out before you're dead. That's exactly what he said. Because there was a real animosity between the Rabbonus and the medical profession based upon the old autopsy machlokus that went on. Now, people talking about brainstem death and the halacha, it never occurred to them to look in the Shulchan Aruch. I mean, you still a pretty good source to knowing what the halacha is. What does the Shulchan Aruch say? Mihu choshev kemes, watch the title even. I don't know if Rav Yosef Kala wrote all the titles, but that's the title from time immemorial. Mihu choshev kemes, who's considered dead? Afa pisho denu chai, even though he's alive. I know half my students that way. One of the big halachic problems is, can a kohen walk into the classroom? Misha nishba machakto, lo bosrimo, or if he's an old man, even not lo bosrimo, I said, Misha nikra migabo, kidogi got a sword cut down the back, his heart is certainly beating. He's dead, he's metame bo right away. Because the organism was destroyed. The organs are there, the cells are there, but the organism has been destroyed. It's in the Shulchan Aruch, why are you arguing? Sorry. The big halachic source that Baich and Shechter and will excite against brainstem death is a Chacham Tzvi. That's a Chacham Tzvi. Back it off. That's a Chacham Tzvi. Happens to be a four-page tshuva. I'm sure they never saw the tshuva inside. Watch what the tshuva says. Here's the site, the main halachic source against the Shulchan Aruch, against the Gemara in Chulin, right? Against the Gemara in Yuma. What is it? The case is a famous case of a shayla of a chicken without a heart. Right? And the maid, etc., is convinced that she didn't lose the heart, the chicken without a heart. So they brought the shayla to the Chacham Tzvi, right? And he paskin, no, it can't be. That the chicken was alive, it had to have a heart. Where the heart? The heart, the cat took it, bellways. You know. But in the discussion, he puts the emphasis on the heart. And that's what they cite. You see, if the heart is beating, the person is alive. Look what the language is. Right? Heyos, inyan ha'chayim tluya b'neshimas. Why? The heart is what? It's totally in what? In respiratory. Right? B'nei. Mishum shederach ha'chotem yotze ha'avir ha'cham min alev v'nichtas bo ave kal right there. Then the kare ha'lev the main lev ein neshima. Yeah. What does he say? This is a proof that first of all, what is he talking about? And why would you look to him for any medical advice when he tells you the function of the heart is what? is to cool the air. All he had was a respiratory system. He didn't have a circulatory system. He knew nothing about circulation. So he had a system in which the heart and the lungs are both respiratory organs. One cools it and one breathes it. And this is the source of halakhic validity that they are citing, that the heart is the essential organ. No one looked at the tshuva. It's a four-page tshuva. And here's the tshuva of my father-in-law, Zatzal.
See if I can blow up something there. What does it say? That breathing aldeha machona, breathing by a ventilator, shah shiyish nafchu kvames, mishima kazu, bahu, ro, mishashev kichai. Okay, then goes, what? Then we have the apnea test, he says, to do it, right? He should leave it al kerevashor. We do it, I think. Yeah, we do sometimes 15 minutes. That's also possible to do, etc., etc. Right? Then, you know, there was no question on this. Then started the attack, first from Avraham Abraham, right? And then came from others here. A truth way, you see, the rabbi, Feinstein changed his mind. He said over there, right, Masha Omre Maroka, what doctors say, that Mitsu Bamoa, that death is brainstem death? Nonsense. But what case is it talking about? Afsha dying who no shame. A man who's breathing independently. Doctors say his brain is dead. Why is he dead? Because he can't do the crossword puzzle. The cerebrum is dead. That's the brain they're talking about. They want to go ahead and extend brainstem death to the cerebrum. He says, no, the man is breathing. You can't do that. This is cited as, see, he holds that what? That brain death is not, of course brain death doesn't mean anything. But I told you when we started, brain death is another synonym for respiratory death. Because the last stage of the protocol is apnea. Without apnea, you don't have a protocol. Am I coming across people? This is critical, you have to know this. And this is already from the Rabbanus HaRoshes, I don't have to show it. Right? No, this is what I wrote. I'm sorry, I wrote to Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach, right? And to Rabbi Hirsch, right? And they left out the shlita at the end, but that's because I don't type. Okay, here's your people up to date. And then comes one of Rav Steinberg's innovation, and it's intriguing that he able to get a responsive audience, and that is to put a ventilator on a Shabbos clock so that you don't have to turn off the ventilator. Aesthetically, it's best. Halachically, it makes no difference how you stop the ventilator. But this is nice, clean. It stops by itself. It's very nice because Rabbi Feinstein Zatzal had ruled previously that we didn't have the oxygen piped in, but we had tanks of oxygen. That when the tank is used up, there's no chiyuv to replace the tank if you feel that the patient cannot recover. And therefore, Rav Steinberg took the same thing and put it on the Shabbos clock. Right? Don't worry about tanks, and now we don't have tanks. But on the Shabbos clock, it means the doctor writes a prescription, 24 hours of ventilation. After that, I'm not discontinuing a treatment. I have to initiate a new treatment. And there's no chiyuv hatzolah on such a patient. Therefore, you don't initiate a new treatment. I'll be happy to take questions later if I missed being clear on any of these points. This is now speaking to the opponents. There's no excuse for the errors that they made. There's no shigogo when you pass a shilas in health, and shilas of life and death. Every shigogo is amazed. My father Zatzal used to say, Moshe says that a shogeg any odeya, he doesn't know that it's halacha on Hilchos Shabbos, that this is a malacha Shabbos. So he has to bring a korban. Why do you want a poor fellow? Why should he bring a korban? He didn't do anything against God. He didn't do an aveira. He didn't know. So my Tata Zazal used to say, you never bring a korban for a shogeg. You bring a korban for the mezid of being an amoetz. Okay, this is hometown from one of the most famous scientific journals, the Hamodia. Okay. And here it starts. This is Rabbi Bleich. Said, it's not true that David Feinstein supported brainstem death in the name of his father, that he denied his father ever held that way. And it's true, by the way, Rabbi Feinstein never approved of brainstem death. He approved of apnea, but the doctors are more machmir than my father-in-law. Where the doctors would be content only with apnea, they also check total cessation of all brain functions, which is not required by halacha, according to my father-in-law. What was required was just the last stage, the apnea stage. What does it say here? All right. This what B'simen referring to that tshuva, kosav shemes, right? Hu she'enu noshem, af adayin, right? Yesh the machine is still breathing for him, right? These dvorim noble vad masherisi kosav, right? Ela b'wat Moses she'yesh ot etc. Idea, Emes, and so on and so on. This letter led to another letter there. And here it's a little clearer because people were bothering him, and therefore he put it again. The language of Rashi. Even though the heart is beating. And Rabbi Bleich has published over and over again that David Feinstein denied his father ever approved of brainstem death. Why do we do such things? And here's a famous letter to Bundy, the grandson of Rav Roy Zatzal, a famous pulmonologist in Brookdale, where he refers to the Harvard criteria. This letter, you notice, was typed. The Shver never typed letters. He wrote everything. But there was a period of time, many months, in which he suffered greatly from arthritic pain. And my father-in-law would write, as some of you people who knew him will, by putting his face literally next to the paper because he had one lazy eye and he was using only one eye. And when he couldn't bend down, he couldn't write the tshuvas. So we had some talmidim from MTJ type out the tshuvas. This is one of the tshuvas, that's why it's typed. But he made sure to put his stamp on and his signature, etc. And there he refers to the Harvard criteria, because Bundy asked in that name. And then Bundy has met with him many times after that there and has spoken publicly there about their meetings. Okay. When Bleich began to spread the word that David Feinstein said some, etc., Asiya in Shari Tzedek, right, Rav Halpern decided to, Bleich cited a fellow by the name of Rav David Shul, whose brother, Rav Pesen Zatzal, was my close friend and neighbor in Muncie. He changed his name for some reason, but the name is Pesen, a famous family on the Lower East Side, right? And there's, what does he say? Kosta Shur, then came along Shari Tzedek, right? Biru Yoshin Imar Abdullah Feinstein, Niger went against what was cited his name, right? There's no Bias Hesor as Eidus Harav Tzedek. There's no contrary evidence. Okay, now starts the published stuff
of Rabbi Bleich, who still has the chutzpah to put his name on the opposition. He's the main source, as you see. He's the one that taught Rabbi Willig and Rabbi Schechter their biomedicine. What does he say? There's a thing called the Lazarus sign. Therefore, there's no evidence that such movement is the product of spinal reflex. Now, anyone knows anything about our history knows that the Lazarus sign is the sign of a patient moving who's been decapitated with a guillotine during the French Revolution. And these people sometimes would show movements. Because there's no evidence that it comes from the spine, it could be coming from the brain. So the question is, how did the brain tell the body? The brain's on one side and the body's on the other side. How did the brain tell the body what to do? The chutzpah, you refer to the Lazarus sign, that's by definition on a decapitated individual. And this comes, this terribly embarrassing thing. 2 years ago, we had a national conference on brainstem death, about organ donation at Columbia, which I presented, and we invited Rabbi Willig to be on a panel, just to show that there's another opinion, and he should be able to defend himself, defend the other opinion. And he cited this thing in the name of himself, but as he's learned it, I told you, from Bleich. What did Bleich say? How could you say that a brainstem dead individual, which means respiratory death, when a fellow who suffered a polio attack, and we now know, once upon a time he'd be in an iron lung. Now we just put two electrodes in the diaphragm, he has a battery in his pocket, and he gets married, and he drives a car, right? He comes to his soil, eats falafel, but he can't breathe. So he says that he should be dead, according to this definition of death. He forgot about Rashi saying, Shochev Kemes. This guy's not Shochev Kemes. He's driving a car, he's getting married, he's having children. Where's the Shochev Kemes come in? The fact that he can't breathe? You eat a piece of steak and it gets caught in your lungs, get caught in your throat, then you're dead. But you don't need a burial, you need a hug. Okay? Need a loving hug called a Heimlich maneuver, that's all. But he couldn't breathe. What's got to do with being dead and not breathing? You forget the whole protocol. There's a protocol for it. And that's the citation. So Willig said this thing in front of a packed audience of doctors and medical students. You should have heard the guffaw, you should heard the laugh that came out. They thought he's telling a joke. A Chil Hashem. And here's the best of all. Okay? We have people I want you to follow. We have a bunch of lumdom here. Black people, the final proof, the Rambam didn't hold the brainstem death. Why? Because the Rambam says in Hilchos Trefos that if a brain is nishpach kamayim, if it spills as water, the animal is a trefo. Now, if the animal were dead, couldn't, because the brain is liquefied, then he would be a nevela, not a trefo. Okay? Some of the women can't follow that, but the men tell about it. Now, I want you to stop and think, you just heard this happen. Anything bother you about this proof? What we're trying to say is the animal was brainstem dead. But I told you brainstem dead means apnea. So where was this animal? In an intensive care unit in Shari Tzedek, right, under Haredi auspices, right? And a sheikh had sneaked in and shechted him. How he got to that ventilator tube, I don't know, right? That's what you're talking about. How could a sheikh had shecht an animal whose brain was lysed? If he was brainstem dead, he had to be on a ventilator. He couldn't breathe. A shecht that can't shecht an animal that's lying on the ground and can't walk, it's also the shecht. Why would he shecht it for? The answer is the word moach could mean brain, it can mean marrow, and can mean spinal fluid. Nishpach kamayim was a constant concern. Animals out in the field were attacked by wild animals, and if they punctured a skull or the spine,
and there was liquid coming out, you quickly call a shochet, sheft him, to try to save him before he dies. She says, no, it's not going to help. Nishra kamayim is a trefo. It's no different than a blemish in the lung, etc., etc. But he's not in the vela because he's perfectly alive. He's breathing independently. But this was published. How do you live with such a publication without withdrawing it? And here I'll make an appeal. I read the scientific literature every week. I read the Journal of Medicine, I read Nature, and I read Science. Not because I'm that interested, but they pay me for doing that. Those are the courses I teach. Every few months you find in there a retraction. John Doe published a paper, he's a dirty liar. He manufactured the experiment, he didn't do it, right? It doesn't exist. We retract it, meaning take it out of the literature. RCA has to retract that 110 pages. They use it for other purposes, but not for reading. Oh, this is such a devastating thing. How do you live with such a thing? Shechted, an animal that was brainstem dead, had to be on a ventilator. But you don't know that brainstem requires a ventilator. Never saw it. Ask any of those rabbanim, did they ever see a protocol done? I slept my shvel Saturday nights to see how they do the protocol in downstate. First time in Good Samaritan Hospital in Muncie. When you see it that way, there's no question. The man is dead. They're fussing with him for some reason. But he's a dead man. Now, like Asher says, you got to prove he's dead. So I'll put a feather against his nose. And this is when we came out under the auspices of Yumi Wolfish Shlita, who deserves much credit for moving us in that direction to accept brainstem death, right? There was an immediate opposition, right? Any opposition there? Oh, nonsense, right? Some blood may flow to the brain for up to 4 days after brain death. Where they get bobomyces? If we can't brain death, there's no blood flow to the brain, period. We do a nuclear scan and show that nothing goes into the brain. Right. Next, the Israeli chief rabbinate, quoted in the proxy, does not mention brain stem death as such. Rather, it refers to irreversible inability to breathe. What the heck are they talking about? Brain stem death is the irreversible inability to breathe. That's the apnea test. The fact that we were machmi, we did other tests to prove, for some reason, and which is now under attack, why do you need it for? Right? And it says what? They did one quarter of the rabbin of the response is devoted to brain death. Watch the term. And this was signed by Rifkin, Schefter, Wagner, Willie, right? And so there's Yechacham Tzvi, the great source of biological knowledge, right? And there. Right? We blew that up for you. And here you have, what's the title? This is the Rabbonus HaRosh's official publication. Right? What does it say? What does it talk about? I know Amal, this is the full thing. Look at what they're talking about, the protocol for brainstem death. Okay. No, they don't mention brainstem. The next page is Kviyas Mavas Mochi. What is that? What are you talking about? Right? Mavas Mochi. What are you talking about? Ingrown toenails? Why would they lie? This is so, I find that so disturbing. I mean, how do you lie and assume you won't be caught?
You make a statement, and it's available to anybody to disprove it. All right, this, I don't need this anymore. Okay. Here's an interesting thing. As some of you people may know the names involved. Barry Hachtov, who some of you people may go to his hotel on Pesach, the Granite Hotel, now a different Hudson Valley Hotel. He's a member of my shul. He was one of the five boys who took my first course in microbiology. There were five students, all became dentists, and all moved to Muncie. All members of my shul. And Barry he was captain of the basketball team. He's not very tall, but he was more successful in knocking down opponents than in getting the ball in the hoop. Tough fellow. Okay? So he went to see Shoshoma Zalman Auerbach. The talk was going around about his rabbi. Did he? Didn't he? What? Right? The rabbi responded by saying he was tired of his question. I told him I was from the United States. Right? He then asked me if I was a physician, where I replied, no, I was a dentist. Interested in the issue. Right? Rav Shlomo Zalman answered me that it was clear an individual can receive or give an organ after brain death. This applies outside of Israel. Okay. I told you that before. That was his hang-up. Okay? Right. And the Rav accepted brain death as the death of the patient. His answer was definitive, clear and firm. All right. Okay? He signed Rabbi Hachtov, yes. I put down at my put the member of first microbiology class taught at Yeshiva College. You heard from Shlomo Zalman, change his mind. Sure, maybe yes. You come and nudge him and give him other things. Finally, I know the last thing he said was, leave me out of the picture. I don't want to be decoded. But this he passed in the shaila for an individual asking directly, tell me yes or no. And here, a dramatic thing. Rabbi Yosef Shrita, his opinion is hard to oppose in Eretz Yisrael. It goes under the term of thought control. And here, strangely enough, you take a note.
It's a tape.
Yeah. Here they finally, on this issue, they opposed him. Both Rabban Soroshis, Rabbi Amar, both of the Rabban, I think. Okay. Rabbi Elijah Yosef Shlita and Rabbi Amar both came out against. Supporting brain center. And here's someone who I believe to be the best posek in Eretz Yisrael today, Rabbi Zalman Nechemia Goldberg. And then here's the opposition, okay, whatever it is. All right, and then what do we have here? That's. Then we have another issue that's some of the slides that you people were scared of. Too many. I'm not going to show those slides. That's an issue concerning should you pay for organs or not. And that's the big trouble going on now. Yet this hasn't been resolved. At the moment in America, it's forbidden to pay for an organ. So they get donors. As Craig Smith once said to me, it's very strange. People show up with cousins willing to donate organs. We're talking about our live kidney donation. He says, but strangely enough, if the fellow is a 6.5-foot Irishman and his cousin is a 4-foot Indian. He doesn't know how that works out. And this, of course, the dangers, et cetera, et cetera. And here, interesting, Rabbi Yosef Shlita came out with a psak forbidding the Israelis to go to China to get organs because they killed their people in order to sell the organs. That's not true.
they are more economical than we are. We kill a person and we waste the organs. They kill a person by organ donation death. It's a new form of dying. That's it. You can hang him, you can electrocute him, or you remove his organs. It accomplishes the same thing. I think that's basically as much as I wanted to share with you tonight. I'd like to leave some time for people who want to clarify things. It's really critically important. Yes.
What's your thoughts about the chief rabbi of England's statement?
I'm sorry?
The chief rabbi of England's statement. What's your thoughts?
Okay. All right. Right. I left that out. The chief rabbi of England, the Besdin, put that back on. Right. Also basically sided with the RCA. I read Rav Zaks's Shabbos sermon every Shabbos. One of my members, the president of my shul, that's why I read it. Fate will fire me if I don't. It is a brilliant exercise in human language, how that man masters the English language. And suddenly, they ask him about the brainstem thing. So here's number one. Somebody asks him, but what about this business about getting without giving? That you can get an organ from a brainstem because he's dead, but you can't give it because you're alive. To which the chief rabbi answered, it's a spurious question. Spurious question. It's a question that's omid bulbul mushalolam. Spurious means irrelevant. He used a word that no one else will understand what it means. Right? And then he comes out with a statement concerning. He says, well, we believe what the Besdin believes, but you should know you're supposed to ask your own rabbi, etc., etc. A man who's mastered the language for clarity suddenly is mumble, bumble, don't know what he's talking about. It's tremendous, tremendous political issues that are here which I don't understand. But the fact is that I would venture to say, I put it as a fact, no member of the Besdin in London ever saw a brainstem death protocol performed. If anyone sees it, you can't have any doubt in your mind. Before the doctor comes to his conclusion that he's brainstem dead, you know very well that man is dead. He looks dead, he behaves dead. This is, Im Yirtzeh Hashem, maybe the Eved, a wonderful thing, to hang the issue up for public review and let the public respond the way they have to respond. Each you have Rabbonim, each you, there are members here of the RCA, there, you still have a voice in the RCA, if you're paying your dues at least. And Mr. Shem, they have to back off. They have to back off first on the, if you don't give, you don't get, that must be established. If it's death for one side, it's death on the other side. If it's not death on one side, then it's not death on the other side. That's the key. And then to review what are the facts and who are the source, what's the source of information. I venture to say that it was the influence of Rabbi Bleich that convinced Rabbi Schefter and Rabbi Willig and the RCA. And I say again, he hadn't the slightest idea what we're talking about. Okay, let me tell you something again from my father's Asal's folklore. He says two yeshiva bochim studying together for 15 years at Raden, then one of them leaves for America. And after 10 years, one of them comes back to see his old chava. So he stops, he doesn't know where he lives anymore. He stops in the first house, he asks, do you know where Rabbi Yankel is?
He says, who, Yankel the Mamza? Goes to the next house. He says, we know where Yankel is. Yankel the Ganef. Finally meets Yankel. He says, Yankel, what do you do here in town? He says, I'm the Rosh Kol. I'm the president of the shul. He says, what do you need it for? He says, I want a little COVID. You say it in the benching. Harachaman hu yifanaseinu b'kovod. You want to feed me a little COVID. They wanted to, whoever site that wrote that thing, largely this Asher Bush, wanted COVID. So he got Bizyonos instead. Right. The definition of death has to do with Adam HaRishon. And Adam HaRishon was not a Ben Noach, he wasn't a Haredi, he was a Tzelem Elohim. Death is determined when the Tzelem Elohim is no longer. That applies equally to Jew, Gentile, Chinaman, Irishman, no difference.
Imagine to the audience that this decision that was made by the RCA now is a direct contradiction to a Mahalakha of the RCA which passed when we accept grandstand death. And they did so without consulting the entire day.
There are a number of strange happenings that Rav Wolfish is referring to. And that is, I just received from Rav Wolfish a letter that he wrote April 2008. I wasn't aware that at that time they already were beginning to discuss this whole brainstem death issue. Yeah. And remember, they also cite Rabbi Soloveitchik that he never approved of brainstem death. Here's the, under when Rav Wolfish was executive director, when the issue was raised, where the Rav Zatzal was active, we came to a conclusion that brainstem death is the only indicia that death had occurred, and therefore came out with a healthcare proxy, which stated so that we approve of organ donation, etc., etc. Then the issue began to ferment. I wasn't even aware of it, but Wolfish was, and there. He cites the decision of the Halachic Commission to declare brainstem death as halachic death. And now this new Halachic Commission is trying to undo that which is a decision which had in it two components. One, the decision of the Rabbonim in America. And two, the fact that the RCA for years had the instruction from Rav Yeshua Be'er Zatzal that we never oppose the decision of the Rav HaRoshi in Eretz Yisrael. Here they violated every rule of the game. No reason for it whatsoever. And here I'll just read you something. I went to see the Rav, it's Rav Yeshua Be'er Zatzal, and explained the test and its consequences. That was when I learned that the nucleus test was available to prove that no blood reaches the brain. And on that basis, Rav Wolfish asked the Rav, is that a good test? And he said, I quote, Tendler says that the test concerning the death of the brain is conclusive, right? And I answered, this is the Rav said, And the answered yes. And the Rav replied, in these matters, Tengel knows what he's talking about, and we can accept this opinion. That was the opinion of the Rav, period. No one ever posed the Rav's opinion. And suddenly, people who never heard their names even, suddenly became the decisors for life and death issues. What has happened now is the RCA will never have budged. But as their president, Moshe Klitenik, said that there was such a furor, such a tumult, people demanding RCA to back off, that they finally had to say, well, we are not making a decision on this issue. We are merely showing both sides of the story. So if you see an analysis, and time didn't allow, a world-famous neurologist studied that they and said this is something that was written only to prove one point, that brainstem death is not acceptable, and cites all the errors in the factual errors, intentional errors, etc., etc. That's available. It's on the internet. If you want to check it, I found it to be a magnificent thing as an old Rebbe. You see how a man who knows what he's talking about has also the gift of pedagogy, of being able to explain the most complex neurological issues in a language that anyone can understand. Noach, the neurologist. Right. Just a brilliant exercise. It's available under Hirhurim. Written by now the one who is now the editor for the OU publications, by Rabbi Student, and it's there. On you can pick it up on the internet under Hirurim, brainstem death or whatever else. I'm sure you'll pick it up. Write a letter. It only costs 44 cents in America. Yeah. Okay.
I'd like to thank Rabbi Tendler for this wonderful lecture.